Of some material. So, first, this is a singing of Tehillim or Psalms. And this is a typical trope that is used for singing Tehillim on Friday nights in the Moroccan community. One of the ideas taken into the Moroccan world outside of Morocco, if you will, is the notion of utilizing these different tropes for different parts of the service. And this is the Tehillim trope.
Amen. אשר ידו את קרי הארץ ותואפות הערים לו אשר לא הים והוא עשהו וימשת הידיו יצרו
Yeah.
Jewish, of course, is a very well-known piece that has traveled the world, frankly, since its composition as a text in the 16th century, and certainly has found a beloved home amongst the Moroccan communities. That is just one of about 30 different melodies for Yidi Nefesh. So you can, on any given week, hear Yidi Nefesh in a different melody, especially for the Bakashot tradition, which I'm going to share a little bit more about in a moment. But that's one that aligns with a light classical piece from the Algerian, that kind of eastern Moroccan region, as I was mentioning before, called Yashikin, which is what I played. This next piece, I think I have it here somewhere. Shuffle around, yes. On Friday nights, the end of services, we usually hear this one. And this is a piece that really emphasizes the monotheistic tradition and principles of faith.
Hallelujah.
this piece is stretching us a little bit. It's called Doroikra. Doroikra is a it's a poem from the Sephardic tradition of Spain, dating back to the 10th century. One of the things that I myself have been positing or finding out, let's say, in my research, is the this idea that there are even multiple diasporic identities at work within this community. So clearly we're all pretty familiar with the notion of a Jewish diaspora and belonging to that. But there's also the notion of belonging to this Sephardic diaspora, this memorializing or longing for this homeland of Spain, and then the Moroccan diaspora, which we've been speaking about. And that Sephardic diaspora could be evidenced in, you know, several different things, from artistic stuff to, or at least visual arts to foods and streams of thought and what have you. But certainly the poetry is a big factor. And so we see a lot of Spanish poets, the medieval Spanish poets, the great poets of Sephardic, their poems, their works coming out in places throughout the community's expressions, from liturgy to para-liturgical stuff. And this is one of those. The Roikra is really the flagship poem of this, really started the Spanish poetic production within the Hebrew community, the Hebraic production. This is written by Dunash bin Labrat of the 10th century, who himself was born and raised in Fez, Morocco, but spent his most formative learning years in around Baghdad, learning with Sa'di Gaon, the great thinker of the Gaonim, who himself was a very strong proponent for incorporating Arabic poetics into Hebrew. And that's what this song is all about, what this poem is about, and what the entire genre of Sephardic poetry is about, is really bringing this Arabic kind of quantitative meter system into a Hebraic lens. So Doroi Kara Levein Imbat is what we would call short long. Doroi Kara Levein Imbat V'yin Sarchem Kemo Vava. So that the language itself has this rhythm to it. Of course, when you set it to music, the music takes over. But this is a Moroccan setting for Doroi Kara, which is commonly sung around the table on Shabbat, and just highlights the joy of having a good weekend. Thank you. repertoire called the bakashot, which literally means supplication poems. And in the Moroccan tradition, from the holiday of Sukkot, which happens in late fall, until Pesach in the spring, the nights are longer and the days are shorter. And so there's a singing tradition in the community to go to bed early on Friday night and get up early on Saturday morning, something like 3 o'clock, 4 o'clock in the morning. Go to the synagogue and sing for about 3 or 4 hours before the sun rises, and then do Saturday morning services. So this intense amount of singing is all based out of a repertoire of a la Andalusia style melodies and rhythms that is coming out of the Andalusian classical tradition, which would be performed outside of the synagogue, of course, with instruments in Arabic or in Hebrew, in this case, performed a cappella. And sometimes these melodies are taken, and sometimes they are performed with instruments as well outside of the synagogue for presentational purposes like this, or other presentational concerts and what have you. So, in any case, every week there's a collection of poems that are performed. As I said before, Yedid Nefesh has like 30 melodies. That's why, because every week it starts with Yedid Nefesh, and therefore it has a different melody for every week. This, which I'm about to play now, is a piece called Ya'ala Ya'ala Bo'il Gani. It's from the Bakashot repertoire, and it comes in, again, a little bit later in terms of the text. It's from 16th century poet, very prolific poet, from northern Israel, Palestine area, called a place called Tzfat. This poet's name is Yisrael Najara. And Ya'ala Ya'ala Bo'i Legani is a common thing. Rise up, and come to my garden. Hinetz Rimon Gam Pachat Afni. The pomegranate is ripe and the grape vine is bursting. Thank you. Judeo-Espanol music really owes it's a preservation mostly to the women in our lives. So, ladies, this is a shout out to you, because this is the music that really comes down to us, you know, on the laps of our moms. And Esther Mubien, of course, begins by putting a very prominent place for Esther, the heroine biblical figure. Esther Mubien, que haremos casa santa flaguaremos con la ayuda de los cielos y el kidisho anuchi. So we get that little bit of Hebrew mixed in as well. We follow with Moshe, subio a los shemayim. So we definitely have the Spanish and Hebrew mixed. He's drawing from the heavens. Sin achila y sin maim, like it's coming down like water. Trajo los luchot shinaim. Now, there's a bit of a play there, because on the one hand, shinaim is two, like the two tablets of the Ten Commandments. But shinaim is also your teeth, which the tablets are thought to have been shaped like your teeth, not necessarily the rounded ones like we see a lot of times. So that's a question. En las kedisho anochi. And of course, kedisho is also like kedish, like holy, holiness, the one, anochi, God. Agais como Avram. Now we're going to get to Abraham. Maestro querido, great, blessed one. Que de los 90 años fue circuncido. So age 90 is when he circumcised himself. We're all pretty young here. I think we still got some years to go there. Guys, como Yitzhak, nuestro querido, que dio su garganta al degollador, that he offered up his neck, as the Midrash and Jewish law often teaches us, and the most important Sephardic poem that we hear on Yom Kippur, Rosh Hashanah liturgy, talks about Yitzhak as being fully aware and knowledgeable of what was about to happen, and that he offered himself up to that sacrifice. Agais como Yaakov, maestro querido, que del salieron las 12 tribus, the father of the progenitor of the 12 tribes. So this is Esther Mubien. I'm just going to play a bit of a selection.
Thank you.
really shows some of the traveling of the community in more recent years, because this is a piece called Eroch Mahalal Mibi, which actually starts out the same as another very well-known piyut or poem that we find around the Sephardi Mizrahi world that says Eroch Mahalal Mibi. It's all about Eliyahu HaNavi. But this one is Eroch Mahalal Mibi La'el Gadol B'Nora Lichbor HaKadosh Rabbi Yaakov Abuchatzira. So who's Yaakov Abuchatzira? Abir Yaakov is the progenitor of the Abuchatzira rabbinic dynasty, which includes the Baba Sali, who is the great Moroccan rabbi of the 20th century, perhaps the greatest figure in the Moroccan community for the worldwide Jewish community, who's buried in Netivot Yisrael. And passed away about 15 years ago, so not that long ago. Anyway, this is several generations back. This Rabbi Yaakov famously travels at one point, the story goes, towards Israel to make a pilgrimage, and then comes back to Egypt, and he is in Alexandria, Egypt, and he says to the community members there, take me to Damanhor, a nearby town, because I want to go there for Shabbat, and that's where I want to pass away and be buried. Okay, so he's going to name his place and day. So he goes to Damanhor, and in Damanhor, he passes away. And the community there think to themselves, no, you know, I mean, this is a great rabbi. We must take him back to Alexandria, where there's a much larger Jewish community, and bury him there. And the story says that every time that they would walk out to go travel to take his body out, it would just start pouring rain so that they couldn't travel. And so ultimately, in Jewish tradition, you know, you cannot wait too long to bury the body. So he's buried in Damanhor, Egypt, even though his family dynasty is really based in Morocco. So to this day, in Damanhor, Egypt, his kever, his tomb, is dressed up and very well taken care of by the local Muslim population, who also see him as a saintly figure, which is not uncommon. I've been to many tombs in Morocco and prayed next to Muslims as well as Jews at these tombs of great rabbis. So this is completely normal. By the way, a little note to my friend Francesco. You know, Edwin Cerussi told me that it's his family that was the house in Damanhor that wouldn't let the rabbi, that the rabbi passed away at.
Are you believed
him? Huh?
Are you believed
him? Yeah. Now, musically, I would like to share something that's a little bit interesting about this piece, which is that this is based really in a makam, a sikah, in fact. Well, actually, it's more like an Iraqi makam, because it ends sort of in an ambiguous position between Sikha and Bayat. But the adaptation of this melody, as I said before, is already well known throughout the Yerushalmi Sephardic world. Now, Moroccans that I know don't think of it at all as associated with the Yerushalmi world, because, of course, the text is about Yaakov Abuchatzira. But also the melody itself they don't even associate, even though it has this quarter tone in it, which is foreign to the North African realm. But really, probably what roots it in the Moroccan vibe more than anything is the rhythm. And that's where Tim comes in. So this is going to be like Karachi. Yeah, exactly. And this... So I hear this all the time in the community.
Thank you. كنفيم قدشوش عمايم ربنان بخل اعتراف يا الشارع لخبتومو بمعساب بمكومو كيا ريح بن يومو زوهي درخ يشارع turban on, dark sunglasses. I think he had a scarf, something like this, actually. But anyway, maybe I took this one. I don't know. So he was walking by, and he had two flutes in his hand, nine flutes, and he had a bandeira. And he's just walking through the square, and boom, he just stops, and he turns 90 degrees right at me, and walks straight over to me and hands me his flute. And I was like, okay. I don't have a form of signs like a musician or anything on my forehead. But, or maybe I do with this hat, but I wasn't wearing a hat. So, in any case, so he, you know, as sheepishly took the flute, happens to be, I know how to play the flute, which is not everybody knows how to play than I. But, so I start playing. And he's like, bravo! You know, so he sits down and I get him a drink. And come to find out, I couldn't really talk to him because I speak French and Hebrew and Shoya Arabia. And he speaks mostly Amazigh and Spanish up there, right? So I'm like, okay, well, we're a little bit at a loss here, my friend. But we totally hung out for an hour because we spoke music. You know, I played the nai, he played the bendir, he played the nai, I played the bendir, and we just rocked on the stuff that we knew together for like an hour. And at the end of it, he gave me his flute. Yeah, which is at home. But this song, which I'm about to play for you, was written for him by yours truly. But it'll be like
thank you.
I asked you to have a question ready and handy, with one last piece that is very common throughout the community, and a short one. It's called Anadinin Dinola.
I'm gonna